All right. Well, we are building this robot, and well, a lot of work designing the robot, placing the sensors, optimizing the vehicle with the arms, and all of that. And the question is, how can we take this robot now and place it in an environment to operate and perhaps replace a diver? This is really a big challenge, especially if we would like to do this operation in autonomous fashion. It is this same problem that we would see if we are doing any underwater archaeology that requires very careful, dexterous manipulation. The arms has to be moving very, very carefully, feel their way, and operate while moving the vehicle without breaking anything. So working with robots is the idea that perhaps those are too much of a challenge for a robot today to be performed completely in autonomous fashion. And this is actually the case in many other applications, such as mining. Can we imagine placing robots to replace the miners? Would that be possible today? It's a question. What do you think? Not yet. So can we find a way around it? I mean, is it possible really to approach some assistance, some kind of interaction with unstructured environment? Well, this is exactly the challenge we're trying to address. The idea is, we know autonomy is making a huge amount of progress in free space. But when it comes to interacting with the world, so here is Ashimo performing this task. This is interaction between the hands, the body, moving and serving a cup of green tea. Now, the question is, how much programming went into putting this demonstration? A lot. And this is really the challenge. The challenge is, how can we approach the idea that a robot can somehow perform those tasks that a little child is capable of? And the problem is really, really difficult as we start analyzing all the different aspects of manipulation. So full autonomy requires perception, task planning, then execution through sensing and closing the loop with the environment. And this is going to be probably happening at some point, but it's not there yet. So how can we move toward that? Well, in industrial robotics, we have been successfully working with the robots autonomously through programming. We spend a lot of money just programming the assembly line, and then the set of robots work without human days and night. Now, can we use teleoperation? Well, the problem with teleoperation is that those systems should not be controlled by the human because they are too complex. Interaction, docking. You can see here how the docking is done by flexing the arms. The thrusters are very slow and they will not be able to make that contact without having a coordination between the macro structure and the mini structure. So the idea is, again, to bring the human at some level, but bringing the human at the highest level possible. This is the human cognition, perhaps, maybe some level of reasoning that is needed from the human, but that would require a lot of skills, competence by the robot. And eventually, we might need to solve problems by going down to the lowest level, that is to touch, feel a problem. So haptic visual oversight of the operation might be a solution. So here is the concept which brings together communication between human and robot through haptic interaction. And you can see here a pilot interacting with a robot and the robot is underwater. And I will be talking about this application and the development a little bit later. But essentially, the idea is to place the human either in direct contact with the robot or through haptic interaction. We need to build manipulation skills. The robot needs to have not only the ability to perform motions coordinated with simple contact, we need to be able to tell the robot to place an object or extract an object. There are a lot of contacts, and this is one of the biggest challenges with those systems. Multi-contact brings internal forces, brings reaction forces, and dynamic motion brings all those interactions together with a rigid environment that brings instability. So if we have a robot that is going to do anything, and we have all these contacts, we have to represent, model all these internal forces, a lot of internal forces there. We need to model the dynamics. We need to deal with a lot of different things. We need to deal with the posture of the robot when it is performing this task while maintaining contact and dealing with the constraints and the obstacles and trying to balance. How can we do that in real time? Well, obviously, if we go to configuration space and try to plan all those motions, it would take a little while. However, if we look how human do it, human, in fact, have separate controllers with focus. We focus on the task. We place the posture to make it easy for the arm to move and to reach. We deal with the constraints. And we do that sort of in a separate controller that are working together. So if we have separate controllers, we need to make sure that a posture is performed in a way that is consistent with the task. This could be done simply by taking the representation of the task and taking its null space and projecting the posture representation in that space. And now both should be consistent with the contact, with the constraints, and with balance. The result is just a simple representation of what we would like to do. And this representation is consistent, and it ends up to be a single point in high-dimensional space capturing the task as a task consistent with all these constraints. Once you have a representation, and representations are very important, once you have a representation, you can find the dynamic by projecting the robot dynamic in that space. And once you have a model, you can have a controller to control motions in that space and apply it to the motors. Here is Oussama performing compliance while moving up and down, making multiple contact, avoiding collision. And this is done simply by applying those constraints together through those connections. So I'm going briefly to talk about two applications. The first one is Fukushima environment, where we would like to replace workers with a humanoid robot. The problem is most humanoid robots were built to move in a flat indoor environment. To go into three-dimensional environment, it would be very difficult for biped robots. So contact-supported locomotion might be a solution if we are able to control contact. And the problem is going to require us to think about how we can detect slippery surfaces, find the friction, balance reaction forces, and achieve that balance while the whole system is moving. This is an example of how complex the environment could be and how robot can do it simply by feeling their way, touching the environment, and balancing those forces based on the feedback from the models. Now, not everywhere you can find the environment to support those contact, so quadruped would be good, but quadruped cannot brings also all the aspect of manipulation that you are going to need when you go in a narrow environment. So what we propose is to use what I call the supraped, which is going from biped to triped to quadruped. And in addition to increasing the balance, you are going also to be able to feel your way. You feel your way by placing sensors on those poles that you are holding. And now the robot is going to have a rough plan and explore that plan and move to making contact. This brings amazing increase in the support area of the robot. And the robot now is going to be able to move and balance in those environments. So the other application is an application that started with the idea of building an explorer for the Red Sea. And this was together with Mecca Robotics. At the time, Mecca, as you know, is now Google, part of Google. Recently, Google acquired Mecca and many other companies. KAUST is King Abdullah University of Science and Technology on the Red Sea. And the idea is the Red Sea is huge in terms of areas that are unknown, and we would like to explore it. And the only way that we can do this today is with divers placing sensors, structures, collecting samples. So the idea is to build a team of robots that would be able to be wirelessly connected to a small station near them through optical modem. And this station provides also power, and this is tethered to the boat. On the boat, the operator is basically able to interact and touch the bottom of the ocean through haptic feedback that is relayed at fast speed. And here is the robot performing those tasks, but the robot has a lot of autonomy to grasp, to move, to locate, to bring those different operations, while the human is monitoring and through the haptic interaction is able to assist, help the robot to perform those tasks. So here is a task that the operator is now performing, and in this task, the robot will use two hands. Those hands are going to provide the robot with feedback to the haptic device that is placed on the boat through this communication. And the operator is using the haptic just to feel what is happening, but most of the operation is done autonomously using the skills of the robot and using also the dynamic control that is implemented on board of the robot. There are multiple views of the robot. There is another robot above that team of robot that is monitoring those robots. And you can now do navigation. You can move the robot here. The robot is testing a valve. And this is, by the way, a dynamic simulation in the water of this system, together with the control, together with the interaction. And you can see the same thing happening on the screen of the operator. The operator is now going to grasp an object on the fly from the bottom of the ocean. And very close. It takes about 10 minutes to learn how to navigate the robot. And here we go. This is the water dynamics. All right. So this robot is being built. It will be swimming at Stanford, so be careful if you go to the swimming pool. Just in case, by the end of the year, we are hoping to complete the design. This architecture is applicable to many different domains, in the ocean, in surgery, on the ground, underground, in the field. Many people have been involved in this. Thank you very much for your attention. Yes. Could you please use the microphone?
Also, have you also looked at the recovery mode? Suppose that your robotic system at some point slips and is about to sleep. How does it enable to readjust into the situation such that it doesn't collapse completely?
We don't lose it. It's very expensive, by the way. So this is done together with a team of robots. So there are rescue robots around. Hopefully not all of them will fail. However, there is a mode where the robot will be brought to the surface. And in this mode, this is a mode that can be activated at any time by the operator or by the local robots around that environment. But there are a lot of features that comes with those robots. This is really a challenging problem to imagine manipulation underwater assisted by the human remotely. But it is the same idea that you can apply in the mines or in extending surgery to create autonomous behavior together, as we heard this morning, and also in the field as well. Yes?
So do you primarily envision these semi-autonomous systems for dangerous, expensive situations, or do you see them getting out of those mining, surgery, underwater situations and being used by ordinary people as well? Do you think there will be a difference between experts using them and just the rest of us?
So the answer is that basically the miners right now are in the mines. We have 300, 400 people killed in Chile, in China, in South Africa every year. And there are a lot of difficulties bringing oxygen and putting a lot of things in the mines. However, if we are able to just take these people to the surface, put them inside comfortable haptic visual stations, they can operate those robots. And the robots themselves will have a lot of autonomy. So it's not going to be completely autonomous, fully autonomous, but the robot will have autonomy, and the skills of those experts will be transferred to the robot. In fact, I didn't talk about how we also learn from expert and build those skills, but this is what is the idea is about.
So you see the people being experts in their own field, but they don't really necessarily need to know much about
robots. Well, eventually you it is maybe 30 minutes training exercise and you're... Yes, indeed. All right, well, thank you again.